Everyone, we welcome you today to our webinar, which is going to be Supercharge Your LinkedIn. It will be presented by me, Priyanka Bhartia. I am the Managing Director for India Operations to Accept You and also the Founder for Admission Specialist. The reason we're doing this webinar is because more than often, the issue that our children in India are receiving is that we don't have enough opportunities. We don't know where to get a research. We don't know where to get internships or work shadows. And I have been noticing over the last many years that LinkedIn is picking up as a powerhouse, not just for professionals, but even for students. Today, our presenters, my co-presenters, are some amazing women, Adhya and Janvi. Janvi and Adhya, can you all please switch on your video so that I know you all are here with me? Ah, lovely. So that's Janvi. Adhya, are you getting on? Janvi, is she managing to get on?
Yes, so, I'm just coming on. I think the camera preferences are a little off, so I will try to do that while Janvi introduces herself.
Super. Ninad is going to be presenting. So Janvi, Adhya, whenever you all need him to roll the slide, you all can just let him know. I'll quickly introduce you all to both my children. So Janvi is currently working at Intuit, but has had a beautiful history of studying at Claremont and then going into other kind of startups, and I let her speak about herself. Adhya is still a student. She's at Dartmouth, and of course, very, very beautiful that she has interned at Facebook and has not done it once, but twice or even thrice. So with that, Janvi, are you presenting first? Can we start? You'll need to unmute yourself, Janvi.
Okay, sounds good. Thank you. Good. Hi, everyone. I'm Janvi. As was shared earlier, I am a product manager at Intuit. I graduated from Claremont McKenna in 2019, and I studied biochemistry and economics. Was really interested in like science and in being a scientist and writing, and so I worked at the Writing Center. I also am an interviewer at Intuit, so I interview for product manager positions and am an alumni interviewer for students going into college. So hopefully I'm gathering a lot of the information that I've learned over my many years at Claremont McKenna and at Intuit to share with you today. I'll hand it over to Adhya.
Hi, everyone. I'm Adhya Koja, and you will hopefully get to see me soon. But I am a rising senior at Dartmouth College. So excited to see all of you here, almost remembering all of the anxiety I was having going into college. I am also an alumni interviewer for Dartmouth, and that almost makes me see the other side of the process. So happy to answer any questions. I have been, as Priyanka Aunty said, I have been a software engineer at Facebook for the last 3 internships, and I'm happy to talk more about that.
Awesome. We can go to the next slide, Nan. Cool. Adhya, do you want to take this one?
Yeah. I don't see the next slide. Oh, nice. Perfect. So I feel like LinkedIn is a pretty new platform, and not a lot of people use that for colleges and just in general. It's something that you should start using, I would say. It's a great way to connect with people, find internships, just discover what you're actually interested in. Also, it's a great place to see what colleges are up to, what interests you really. Like, we don't really know what colleges are all about, what they care about, till we look at what they post and things like that, that you can discover on LinkedIn. And essentially just have a presence in a community with like-minded people where you can learn a lot more and show yourself to the world in whatever form you are, more than just a resume. Nilat, do you want to go next?
I think we're ready for the next slide. Awesome. So this I think is my biggest piece of advice, where there are a lot of platforms online where we show people what we do. Social media is one really big example of it, but LinkedIn is kind of more than coming to life in the way that you can do in a resume or something on a website. It's almost like a 3D version of yourself. And so my biggest piece of advice from today, if you take anything away from today, is show, don't tell. In the language that you use, in the links that you add, you know, when you describe the work that you do, talk about what you did, how the organization or the internship or the school would be different without you being there, or the impact that you as an individual have had because of your personality and your skills in that organization. So exhibit that in a way that is more than just a resume. Use links, pictures, examples, personal stories, exhibit who you really are. And, you know, you can use links to even the company's website if there was an internship at, you know, a nonprofit or something like that. Or you can use pictures from a volunteer experience. It just makes you look much more real and much more genuine. And that's something that we'll get to a little later in this presentation. But you really want to show people who you are rather than just telling them who you are. And this content, as you might have noticed on like Instagram or Facebook, whatever else you use, represents who you uniquely are, and you want that to come across. Another really simple piece of advice is just like update your headshot. That's also representative of who you are. There's a headshot and there's a cover photo on LinkedIn, and that's a really great spot for people to identify you, to you know, start building up your brand. So definitely try to exhibit those examples. And now, if you want to go to the next slide, I have some examples there of language that you can use to show and not tell. So for example, if I worked at LinkedIn, which is a platform for professionals to connect with each other, I would want to talk about what I do at LinkedIn specifically, what my role is, how many people I work with, what impact I have within LinkedIn as a large organization, and how, like, what specific characteristics of mine are important for my role at LinkedIn and what I bring to that team or that platform, and what I've left as my impact at that organization. So similarly, if you are a college student, you want to talk about what you know about yourself as a college student, how you bring people together, and what you lead as, for example, as diversity initiatives, and how often those are, and what exactly you do in those weekly sessions, and how many people attend them. So you want to give numbers when possible, examples when possible, even reference people if possible, put in links where possible. So nothing should be left vague and to anyone's imagination. You want to show them as much as you can, because this is the one spot you have to exhibit who you are. And your resume has, you know, three bullet points under each pointer, or under each, you know, school or academic achievement or anything else you have. But LinkedIn is kind of where you can go all out and build a personality for yourself without having to build a website, without having to build a portfolio. So it's kind of this like built-in platform for you to be who you are. Good. I think we're ready for the next slide again. Did you want to take this one?
I think I'll go for this one, Janvi. So here's what we're going to be doing. I'm going to try and show to you what essentially students have done once they've actually got into college. Now, if you look at the left one, experiences are well defined. Roles are clearly mentioned. Dates are clearly mentioned. What is the quantitative or the action that this person has taken is very clearly mentioned. We're trying to avoid names at this point of time. But if you look in, you will see very clearly that he's showing a movement. So there is a tech consulting, then there is a movement into supply chain consulting, and then there is a movement as chief of staff. And this is what we're trying to do. And each one of them, if you would have gone into the details, they have exactly what Janvi was saying. There's links. There is letters of recommendations. There are shout outs. There are accolades. There is everything that's mentioned inside this category, and that's how you have to build it up. If you look on the right side again, you will see this young girl, what she's done in college has been highlighted very clearly. What clubs have been joined, what roles has been played, what is the purpose of doing, what is the kind of research report she's written. So she's written a report under, you know, even UChicago Booth Professor Raghuram Rajan. So it is very clearly mentioned, as well as the research is put in there. So a lot of times, a lot of you students put a lot of money into creating a website, or you'll try and show yourselves through Zimi. What I think is better is this, because you can reach out to colleges, you can reach out to students, you can reach out to people who may even consider hiring you for some reason or the other. And it really builds your network ability. Let's say you belong to an IB school. There are probably 50 students who've already gone abroad to study there. This is an amazing way for you to connect with them and say, hey, how do you like UPenn or Dartmouth? What is it that I should do? Would you be able to read my supplement essays? Is there something else you'd give me as a tip? Right? So those are the kind of examples that you could work on. Ninad, would you like to move on, please? So this is the schools. Now, essentially, if you're still in school, one of our students is doing this. So she has started a nonprofit. She has given a lot of details of that. Not just that, she's also attached the media coverage she's got under this, which is something you can do. And when you do a media coverage, you can do a hashtag to the people who are a part of it, which means they can read it, they can like it, they can comment it. So in a way, it is once again just validating what you have done without the college having to look for it. You know, at the end of the day, your Common Application portal allows you to write your activities in 150 characters, okay? Not words. 150 characters, which is barely, I think, about 15 or 18 words. Correct me if I'm wrong, Janvi Adia, but that's what I think it is, about 15 to 18 words. How much can you elaborate in that? Your resume has to be one page long, nothing more than that, and not even 75% of the, at least 75% of the colleges will not take a resume. So this becomes a solid, stellar way of shining yourself through. So this is something you really, really need to look at. We've taken another one. This other person also, if you notice, has done very interesting work within robotics and within, you know, programming with an institute where it's done online courses and through Coursera, but has been highlighted very well. A lot of you have been told to do online courses. A lot of you have been told to do a summer program, and you all do it, but you all don't know where to showcase it. Well, here's the right place to do it. It's just about writing it very well. Remember, quantify every step, actionable every step. So for example, if you've started something, co-founder of whatever organization, led a team of 3 to 35 in 3 years. Notice the way I'm using numbers, okay? Trained 22 underprivileged students for 4 English courses. So constantly show action and quantify it, okay? And keep upgrading it. Ninad, next, and I believe the kids are going to take over that one.
All you out there.
Cool. Heads up, my video is not going to be connecting because my OS version is different from the webinars platform. But so I just wanted to talk about LinkedIn being just a starting platform. I know I said that it's a great way to create a community, and all of that begins with you taking that action to do more than just existing. There are a lot of hidden tools in LinkedIn that people should be using and often don't know about because of how it's created. There's filters on LinkedIn that help you identify who you should reach out to, or whether that be your, which recruiter is good to reach out to for your colleges, or what students you have common with that go to that school. For example, if I want to find somebody who goes to Dartmouth, for example, you can always put in search Dartmouth College and maybe undergrad, or like put in different filters, and it'll give you common people that either I know or that you know who have gone to Dartmouth College, which is a great way to reach out to people and just understand what certain college cultures are like, what recruiters are looking for, how you can be set apart from the rest of the students. And also a great way to do it is, even if you can't message those people on LinkedIn itself, because that's a premium version we can talk about a little bit, you can kind of guess their emails. Most people have their first name, last name at gmail.com or first name, last name at company.com. .com or .edu or things like that, that you can pick up and just guess and try to reach out to the people you want to if there's no way you can message them, which is a great way. There's also LinkedIn Learning, which I've previously learned Photoshop on it and different skills. And this is where all of your skills come in for LinkedIn. You can, so there's parts of your application where you'll be able to show what skills you are. Your essays will show certain different things. But if there's a specific skill, say leadership, that you want to show, you can put it there. And if you say, for example, you're going into computer science and you don't know Java, for example, you can say you're learning it on LinkedIn. You can show what courses you're taking, which is a great way to just make recruiters see that you're doing something about the skills that you want and showing that you are willing to go above and beyond to do what you want to and to pick up what you think you should. Also, coming back to the premium version, as I said, you can guess a lot of emails. The advantages of premium, in my opinion, would be being able to message anybody you want and being able to see who is seeing your profile, and just in general, the cycle of like which people are seeing other recruiters, which people are seeing other colleges. If I see this college, which other people are seeing that college and which other colleges they're seeing, and just like make this link of and expand how much research you're doing. However, the reason I don't use premium, and I have, and obviously this is up to you if you think this is useful, but the reason I don't use it is because, especially to get into college, you have a lot of things that you can do that don't require the premium version, or you don't really have to worry about who's looking at who, because mainly college, like knowing who's looking at who is more for jobs and when you're trying to get into that community of people, versus right now at the stage of getting into college, you're at the stage that you want to know more and collect more information and do more research and just have a clear presence, which is all possible with the basic version. Also, just like the other tools we've talked about are all available in a free version that doesn't need you to pay yet. So I think that the normal version is fine, but obviously they also have this 1 week free for a premium version. Would say try it out, see if you think that's an investment you want to make. The other thing I want to talk about was posting versus reposting. This confused me a lot for a long time. I always felt like people were either sharing too much, or like I wasn't creating as many posts as other people, or how many is a good number. There's always those questions of what you should present, and posting is great if you have something specific to say, if you want to show certain things, but reposting is great if you want to use another organization's credibility to prove everything you've done. So on your LinkedIn profile, you're going to describe what you've done, which companies you've worked for, what internship experiences you have, what research you've done, what clubs you're a part of for school. And all of those things can be shown further by reposting. So if your school posts a dance show that you were in, or your school annual day, you can repost that and say, look at that, like, I'm the lead role in this and this, and I want my recruiters to see this. That's when you repost something. And posting is when you want to be like, this is what I did in my free time. I built a robot. Like, here you go. This is amazing. Like, this is how it works. Even if it's literally from point A to point B, it just slides. Like, it can be as basic, but just something you want to show that you can't show on LinkedIn and on your resume, which is pictures, videos, links. Those things are things that you can post. So now that I think we can go to the next slide.
One really quick note on posting and reposting. A lot of it, in my opinion, is building credibility and then building a brand. And both of those can be done in a lot of other ways through your headshot and the other content that you have on your page. But reposting and posting is a really quick way for you to get on the radar of other people that might be interested in your work, or get on the radar of organizations that you're a part of. So if you're a part of a school, get on their LinkedIn, which creates a network effect, and you get to meet more people through it, and more people get to see your work, and you build a credibility based on the school's credibility. So that's a really great benefit of it, but at the same time, it means that you have to manage the quality of it, because it is representative of who you are. So you don't want to post or repost anything that isn't interesting or representative of who you are.
I have a question here, Janvi and Adya. So when we do a post or a repost, it is different from commenting, correct? Because I do feel a lot of times when you've commented on someone's post, and I know I do a lot of it for, you know, especially women empowerment or youth empowerment related. And what I write, I realize generates the response. So in a way, it's probably validating what I feel. So let's say I reach out to Aspire for Her. There was a post of Indra Nooyi, and I wrote about what I felt, you know, what Indra Nooyi has done and how it kind of coordinates or collaborates with what we are trying to do at Admission Specialist. Now, is that different?
Yeah, I think it's almost a better and more low effort way to interact with the audience on LinkedIn and the network that you have. Commenting can be a great way of showing what you like or showing what is representative of you outside of creating content and managing that brand and managing that quality of it. So totally agreed that commenting is kind of this mini version of doing the work that reposting and posting requires and allows you to piggyback on the work of other people in your network. So like you did on the post by Aspire for Her, it's someone else has done the quality management, but you can say, kudos to this, or I support this, and create a comment that is meaningful and thoughtful so that it generates a response and creates some amount of emotion or some amount of response from the rest of your network.
Also, another note on that is the comments do show up on your profile. So whatever you say, it's not just for the reader to see, but other people can also see what you've commented on, which is a good thing to know, just because if you, like, you can write something really meaningful and it's not going to get lost. It is going to show up on your profile. So
that was very important, because that's exactly what I was going to ask, Adya. Thank you. At this point, I do want to remind students, parents, you can put your questions on the question box that you see on the right side of your screen. We are going to attempt to answer as many of them as we can towards the end of the presentation. Remember, you can also follow us on acceptyou.india. We're going to be giving away 3 free mentorship packages today. So, you know, if you're one of the first 15 or 20 people who like and follow us on acceptyou.india, you may win a chance to be mentored by Janvi or Adya. So with that, please continue. Thank you so much.
Yeah, on that note of creating a brand and posting, commenting, reposting, people want to help other genuine people. You want to come across as who you are, and I've been talking about representing yourself and building your brand, but the really simple ways of doing this are also in your one-on-one interactions on LinkedIn. So outside of who you show up as in your profile and on someone else's wall where you have created or commented, you also have one-on-one interactions. So a couple notes on how to do those right. Don't copy paste your messages, because you want to say something that allows people to remember you. If you're reaching out to an admissions officer for a college, you want to say why you are interested in that college, why you're reaching out to this admissions officer. If you're reaching out to a student at that college, you want to reach out to them and say what exactly about their profile interested you. You want to remember to personalize. Even adding their name is a really small way to personalize it. Don't spell it wrong. And don't copy paste. Everyone can tell when you've done that. So remember to personalize that. And don't connect without a message. Connect. You have the option. You have to add a note after you click on the connect button. It takes a couple more seconds, but it makes a whole lot of difference. If the chance of someone connecting back with you when you sent just a connection request is like 5%. Then with adding a message, it's at least 25%. Like, you can 5x your impact by just adding a message and increasing the chances of someone being interested in connecting with you, even especially if it's a cold connection, right? Like, a cold connection is when you don't have anything to do with this person, but you just found them online. And a warm connection is if you actually know them, they're a family friend, they're a friend of a friend, and they know who you are or your name. So especially when you're cold connecting, don't connect without a message and don't copy paste your message. And don't be vague or generic. Like, be specific about why you're reaching out. If you want to join their network because you want to learn about that college, if you want to join their network because you're interested in something that they post about and you want to follow their achievements. There are a lot of specific things that you can want from someone, and that will make someone want to connect with you much more than a vague, like, I want to be friends. LinkedIn is not a platform for that. You want to be really specific about your ask. So don't be vague. And this might sound silly, but don't use big words without reason. I've had people send requests with big words used in the wrong way, and it just, or with the wrong meaning, and it just, it comes off worse than not using the words in the first place. So just be who you are and try to represent yourself through your language. So be genuine. And another place outside of the one-on-one interactions, because when you send a connection request, you can actually only send a message that's 250 characters. So you want to represent yourself in the summary. And we've been talking a lot about your LinkedIn profile and all of the different features. But the very first thing that a person sees when they click on your name, assuming you have a headshot, they are interested in knowing who you are. After you send them a connection request, they click on your name, they see the summary right under your headshot. And that summary can be a story, or it can be a little anecdote about what makes you you. And this is a great way to represent how genuine you are, who you are. Maybe you can talk about, I'm interested in women empowerment because growing up I had this one experience, or my grandmother taught me this one saying or anecdote and it stuck with me forever. So really share like personal examples of what makes you you. You can share interesting things about your personality, if you have like quirks that make you really good at soccer or make you really good at something else. Please share those in that space. You want people to remember you after they've clicked out of your profile. You want them to be thinking about, oh, I connected with this person, how can I help them? Or I connected with this person, what are opportunities that might interest them? So if you're trying to create that like long lasting impression, being genuine is the easiest way to do that. Yeah, that's a big one. I think we're ready for the next slide, Nam.
I will add to Janvi's point here. When you're writing your summary, remember the key word is summary. You cannot have an essay there, and you cannot have a lot of random information about yourself. Choose your priority. So if you are a bioengineering student looking for an opportunity to do a research paper, that's fine, mention it. If you want to work in the nonprofit space like I do, then mention that. But you have to be very clear that those two or three lines should be able to highlight one aspect of you. Don't try and make it too many stories into one story, exactly like what you're probably taught about your Common App. Take a tiny slice of your life and build on that.
Good. So one of the other things we've been talking about is that it's not enough to just make a profile. I'm often guilty of this where it just exists. I do nothing else on LinkedIn, and then a few days later, I'm like, oh no, like I need to reach out to people. I need to do all of the things that we've been talking about till now. And that's something important for you too. There are all of these tools, but they're only as useful as you want them to be. They're not, LinkedIn's not magic. You're not going to get anything just by existing on that platform. So a large thing goes to message people from there. And something I think to add to everything Janvi said in the previous slide, when you message somebody, and I used to do this when I was trying to get into college, was I would just message them, even if not LinkedIn, like even email, I would message them being like, I'm thinking about applying to Dartmouth, can we chat? But like, you need to give a little more than just can we chat. Nobody's going to invest all of their time or like even an hour of their time in you if you don't tell them why, and if you don't tell them why they're important to you. Make the other person feel special. It's fine. Like you need them, you have to ask them for exactly specifically what you want. And if it's a question you can ask on chat, please don't ask for a call. It only breaks that connection more than builds it. So definitely, but do use it. Like that doesn't mean you be scared of using this tool. Like definitely message people. Just be specific. And as we said, email people. A large thing that I found helpful is just join a lot of groups. A lot of people post resources that are helpful for colleges, for jobs, for research opportunities. And like even in comments, you can read people's comments and they'll put even more opportunities in the comments of the opportunities. So it's just a great way of like linking things and finding out what there is that you're interested in and taking up those opportunities. A lot of posts are also like, if you're interested in this, email, put down your email in the comments and I will email you this resource. Like, definitely do those things. Like, put in your email. Most of the comments I do is putting down my email for things so that people can send me what resources they have, which is a great way of just collecting things and reading them and however useful they are to you. Also, you can follow companies and follow colleges. They post a lot of what's happening, especially right now with COVID going around. A lot of the news that I like to see is what other colleges are doing and restarting, what my college is doing to be COVID safe, what opportunities they're trying to build in 2021 and 2022. Like, my college is building a new building, and I've been seeing pictures of how the construction is going for the last 2 years, for example. So just things like that that make you feel a lot more connected. And just, I feel like websites for colleges are so hard. Like, it's insane that we just pick colleges based on how well a website's made. To me now, that's just how well their website designers do and not how well their college does. And that's a great way to find people from there and look for what their college is posting, because that's what they really believe in. And that's something that you want to do to fit into that college. It's not just how pretty or prestigious it is, also just like how much you genuinely think you can be at that place. And that's why, that's a large part of why you want to follow these people and colleges. And then the skills you want to, we talked a little about LinkedIn Learning and showing the skills that you, and learning the skills you don't have, but it's also important to show the skills that you don't have or do have or trying to learn. So there's this really good part on your LinkedIn profile, which is called endorsements, which is where you can put what skills you're trying to learn and different people can kind of prove that you have them. So they'll kind of say that, yes, you're a public speaker. So for example, if you're in your student council, but and you want to show that you have spoken, but you're not talking about it in your application, say that you're a public speaker. You're Other people in your student council will be like, yes, she totally is. Like, yes, she gave a great speech. It's a great way to, colleges only ask for like 2 recommendations at the most, or and not a lot ask for peer recommendations. So I would say this is a great place for them to be, to prove your credibility again, being like, yes, she was a great team leader for my sports team. Yes, she was whatever. So I would say definitely, even if it be a friend's friend or like your friend's mom who you worked with, it's a great place for them to just vouch for who you are, which is really important to recruiters, because it even it, and they don't need to know who they are. They just have to know how genuine you are and whether that's what you're saying on your whole application is true. And that's basically what LinkedIn comes down to, right? Like, it's more than your resume, but also great way to reach out to people, but just have that presence. So definitely show up when your skills were of what you're trying to seek and show.
Adia, can I bring out a point of yours here? You mentioned about how colleges' websites can be so crazy tough and so dependent on the designer mm-hmm. rather than the college. Do you also feel that the LinkedIn would be more dynamic, like it would have more real-time information?
Like, in terms of what they post, then I would say yeah, because there a lot, like, there's genuinely just people who are sitting on social media for colleges, right? They're constantly wanting to show their alumni, or like for colleges, what they have in posting is to get more students, to get better applications, to get alumni to endorse them, like to give more money. So they also are trying to show a great front and just all of the news that is upcoming. And that's why I would say it's always real time and they're trying to show as much as possible.
So I think a takeaway here, students, is that let's say Dartmouth is starting a new building. Let's say the new building is for engineering or computers. I'm just giving a hypothetical example here. That can make you as a student a little more alert that, oh, they are starting a new building. They may be looking to increase the number of students mm-hmm. they take. So, you know, that also helps you know a little more strategically which other colleges to look at. You know, I'm not saying you have to fall in love with every college, but you can be smart to understand your particular major, what is being defined, or what is the new being added on by other colleges? Am I correct, Janvi Adya, to assume something like that?
Yeah, I would say so. Also, in addition to that, just knowing the news of that college is kind of important, because then you can bring it up with your recruiters. You can bring it up with what you're trying to show. You can say things that you're interested in what they're trying to build. You can show that you're so invested in them that you know everything about that, not everything, but you know a lot more about that college than what is shown on their website, because you've been part of that news, because you're reading more about them than just what you need to.
100% agreed. I think the one thing that we haven't covered, but we're trying to get at, is that LinkedIn is passive signaling that you are interested in something and that you are making an effort to connect with that, whatever that thing is. So for some of you who might be in high school trying to figure out what your dream college is, you are trying to apply to colleges that you would love and you would like attending. So as much as you are scoping out, you know, their new buildings and what opportunities there are, you also want to see what there is out there that would interest you. And you want to talk about those things so that the college can accept you. And then it goes both ways, so that you have found this community through a platform, and then that community has made a space for you to join them. And then for you at a job, you want to know how the company's revenue is doing. You want to know what the company's future strategy is. You want to know those things. And a lot of that is represented on a public facing platform like LinkedIn. So you're creating the right moments for you to represent yourself, but you're also engaging with information so that you can get your foot into the door and become more active on the platform, rather than passively consuming news about those schools or colleges or companies and not doing anything about it. Yeah, I think we are ready to move on to the next slide though. Awesome. So we are on a summary slide. Want to talk about some of the things that we've covered. The two major audiences that we've talked about are high school students going into college who are trying to reach out to recruiters or other students to understand what it is about that college that is appealing, and then students in college looking for internships or jobs. And the four big things that we think will get you success through LinkedIn is: one, show, don't tell. Represent yourself. Give examples of what you did and the impact that you had as a unique person. Be genuine, and other people will want to help you. And honestly, pass this forward. So if you do get that internship, make sure that you also answer other people who reach out to you on LinkedIn. Like carry it forward, you know, just do what you can. I tried to do that. A lot of people helped me to get to the jobs and colleges that I wanted to attend, and I try to help people as a result of that. So be genuine in all of your interactions, and people will want to interact more with you. Be persistent. Most people aren't ignoring other people on LinkedIn or on email because they don't want to help, but it's because they haven't seen the message or they don't have the time for it. So be persistent. And when you are genuine, that persistence will help you get your foot in the door, and people are likely to respond to you, connect with you, and share resources with you. And then be an active user on LinkedIn. LinkedIn is more than a portfolio, more than a resume, more than just a website. It's a place with a lot of tools, a place with a community that is thriving. It's almost like its own world out there, where you can engage with other people through groups. You can learn different skills. You can exhibit your skills through endorsements. You can summarize your story and talk about the impact that you have in the world through your posts and reposts. So be active and not passive, and make the most of this community that exists out there.
So Ninad, maybe you could move to our contact us box, and I could take on the questions here. So Janvi, Adya, you guys could answer this. Who authenticates the credentials on LinkedIn? I think the bigger question is, does it need authentication as well?
Yeah, I think this is where one of the first key points that we were talking about, show, don't tell, shows up. There is no authenticating. People probably use the platform to lie or exaggerate their impact, but you can do that by both being you can avoid that and avoid people feeling like they need to validate your work by showing the impact that you had and by being genuine. Both of those things automatically validate what you did. You probably cannot lie about how many students you worked with or get fake endorsements or get, you know, it's easy to validate yourself because of the language that you use and the specificity that you have. So if you're vague, then it could look exaggerated where people might question the validity of your information. But if you are showing your impact and being genuine about it, I don't think that there's a chance that people question your achievements, which I think is awesome about LinkedIn.
Also, that goes to say, don't lie on it. There are other people in your same school. If there were 500 people in your school and you were doing something with those 100 people, don't say you did it for 500 people. Like, your friends kind of know whether you're lying or not. And that's why the community is kind of based on trust rather than having to validate it.
Absolutely. And in a way, I think that's what both of you have been harping upon. This becomes a platform to reach out to people who believe you, who've seen your work, who've measured you. So nothing can be better validated than this. Right? So I do think there's no need for a credential or authentication, but the fact that you are on LinkedIn and being able to reach out to people itself should be a lot. So the next question, and a question that really is getting me to think, Adhya and Janvi, and maybe y'all could help me with it. How do we connect the Common App to our LinkedIn profile? How do we get the prospective unis to see our profile on LinkedIn?
Yeah, I can go for that. I would say one obviously clear way is I have my LinkedIn on my resume itself. At the top, you can link your personal website, you can link your email ID. There you can also link your LinkedIn. I also, just for the computer science people out there, you can also link your GitHub if you have projects there. Those are certain links that I have, and that's like a direct way to do it. But more of an indirect way is what we were talking about earlier, which is when people do look you up, then you can show all of the skills that you don't have in your Common App. So it's kind of making your personality a little bit of a whole, because the Common App at the end of the day, I think, is just both parties trying to decide if you fit into that college. And that's where LinkedIn is, you're showing parts that you haven't shown in your Common App. Because like, hopefully, or like, at least I couldn't show all parts of me, right, on one essay or two essays. So just show parts that you don't have and that interest in that college.
Janvi, would you like to add anything?
No, I think you can reference your LinkedIn in your Common App if creating that has had a really big impact on you. But I think connecting it to your resume through just adding a link where you have your other phone number and email ID is a great way to do it. But you can also just drop your LinkedIn as a great way to connect with people on even a platform like this. If you're attending a webinar and there are other people that you want to connect with, that's a place you can drop your LinkedIn link, for lack of a better word. But I can't think of other ways that you can connect it to your Common App other than talking about the same story on both.
Here's what I think. A lot of times you don't really have to show off through a link. If you're commenting, if you're saying something which is integrally important, let's say there's a college, and I know a lot of colleges are speaking about the Afghanistan war, for example, and you feel strongly about it, then, and you have an opinion which is not brash, not rude, not crazily one direction, but there's some research you've done and you write about it, chances are that someone in that college is picking up your comment and saying, that's an interesting one. Let me look at who this kid is. You really never know who's forming an opinion of you or an impression of you. So which is why the whole purpose of LinkedIn is, if you do know something, elaborate, speak, reach out. And if you don't know something, learn. Both the opportunities are available here. And I think that's how you could, and correct me if I'm wrong, Janvi and Adya, but I genuinely feel that a lot of times it's not about showing yourself right up front. It's what you do at the background that can really help as well.
100% agreed. All the little things add up to make you who you are, rather than big, bold posts on LinkedIn alone.
Okay, I don't understand this question. If either one of you do, can you repeat what to follow? I mean, are they talking about which sites to follow or which people to follow? I'm not sure.
Yeah, potentially groups and people to follow. So one feature I guess we didn't talk a lot about is being able to follow people outside of connecting with them. So if there are big speakers or just tech enthusiasts, so for example, a lot of people follow Bill Gates. You could follow people that whose work you're interested in, because you probably can't connect with them. And so you would be updated on the news that they are engaging with or things that they are posting. And then also similarly for groups, you could follow groups. So if you're an environmentalist and you want to follow organizations that are taking green initiatives in Bombay, you can follow those groups and request to join them. Sometimes they're private, sometimes they're public, but either way you can find someone or the other, since LinkedIn displays a list of who's in that group, who can let you into that group if it is private, but you are able to follow groups and just search for them publicly. So I think that's a pretty good way to engage in one of those ways that you were talking about, which is engaging with a platform through your smaller actions rather than making a big statement.
So Janvi, Adya, maybe both of you could speak about one such group that you follow and how it's added value to you. So I think the children might be able to understand it a little better.
Yeah, I think the one big thing, and if you attended the IG Live video that we did with AcceptU a couple days ago, you should follow them on Instagram, but we talked a little bit about this there. I have gotten a lot of value from LinkedIn by reaching out to speakers and other people that I never thought that I would be connected with. I like attending conferences and webinars like this, and have heard a lot of great people speak, and I have been able to reach out to them on LinkedIn after. And even though I'm just an audience member, might not have engaged with them in any other way, they have been open to accepting a LinkedIn request or even chatting on the phone after that. I found like a really great mentor, a professor at Stanford, through that. And, you know, he flew me out because he was like, let's talk about your thoughts on my speech over lunch. So things like that happen only through a public platform like LinkedIn. You don't have to have have anything fancy to say. You just have to have something genuine to say.
Wow, amazing, Janvi. Thank you for sharing that. Adya, will you be able to share one as well?
Yeah, for sure. No professor has flown me out yet. That is unfortunate. But I think I've gained a lot of value from just... I think I've gained a lot of value from being a part of... I'm part of a lot of design groups in college, a lot of the alumni that pass out of college and are interested in design. So there's like 1,000 member group of just designers, because it can be a pretty tight-knit community, even though 1,000 seems like a lot. But that's all people that have come out from like a similar background and look for opportunities. And every single day there's a new job opportunity posted there of my company is doing this, like if you want to apply as a designer, come do this. My company is offering this if you want to apply as a software engineer, do this. I will give you a referral. Like a lot of people post for I'm happy to refer you, because you've become a part of that community and you're part of that group where they feel like you would be a good addition, and they're happy to vouch for you whether you personally know them or not, because you're part of that community. So a lot of places, like I'm going to start recruiting again, so that would be, I can ask for on that group being like, I'm looking for this, if anybody has a role in mind or can refer me, I'm happy. And people would be very happy, like lots of people would comment back and be like, yes, what do you want. So that, I think that's something that I found really useful.
There we go. So I'm hoping students, you all realize this is a huge takeaway. I'm getting a lot of questions about the recording of this webinar. I do apologize. We do not share recording simply because of the privacy and the confidentiality that we like to maintain for our students who are presenting it along with me. I do have questions about a student who's saying, should I start in grade 10 to build a LinkedIn account? Absolutely. Why not? It's not as though it's something that goes defunct. It's something you can gradually build upon. Look at it as a pyramid. And in fact, that is what I'm going to end our LinkedIn with. We have lots of little packages that we're offering. You can be mentored by Janvi or Adia. You can have Janvi, Adia, and me work with you. So we have little value add packages that are offered to you. We're also giving a free chance to actually win a free package with us as well. But all of that, you can either write to us on Instagram or WhatsApp us on the 773-804-8111 number. Thank you so much, Janvi and Adia. I do apologize for the delay in our start because I guess all our systems were not in sync. But both of you have been terrific and I feel eternally proud of both of you. I have to say that. Nina, thank you. You're always a presence with us with all the presentation work that you have to keep showing, although you don't show your face or show your voice to us. So good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Once again, remember, LinkedIn is a very powerful tool. Don't use it lightly or don't not use it at all. So good night, everyone. Good morning, Janvi and Adia. Hope you all have a fabulous day at work today.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Adia. Thank you, Janvi. Bye-bye.
Bye.